What was I going to say? So just to give you a little bit of background context with this project, my PhD project was mainly on Origen's Trinitarian theology, Origen of Alexandria, the 3rd century Greek father. But my interest in patristics all started in my time at Heathrow College in London when I was doing my master, when I got very interested in how the church fathers were used by a lot of modern theologians as a source to think through how theology today can deal with some of the problems that we face, especially in terms of the legitimacy of the discipline in the intellectual discourse in modernity, as well as some of the problems with societies and so on. And in the 20th century, many of such projects have been made. And that's when my supervisor told me, well, if you want to look into things like this, you should make a PhD in patristic first, because then you'll have the skills and so on to talk about these topics. That's why I spent the last 3 years working in mainly anti-Nicene Christian literature, but mainly focusing on Origen, who was, as you discover soon, but also in the course of this time when I'm here, the center figure for this kind of program. So using patristic as a renewal for modern problems. So how much do I have again? Okay.
As much
So
as you want.
I have
45
prepared a
minutes is
paper
okay.
that probably will take about 45 minutes. And I'll go for it, because as you can look for the handout, the first section of the paper, I'm going to give you two examples of this kind of interesting rethinking about the role of patristic in relation to problems of modernity. And my main section of the paper will be engaging with Henri de Lubac and Hans-Urs von Balthasar's monograph on a particular Greek father. So Balthasar on the Greek of Nyssa and Origen on de Lubac on Origen. And I'm going to argue that in these monographs, they have a unified vision, a coherent vision for carrying out this kind of project that I'm talking about. So the first section is to contextualize this sort of project in modernity, and the second is the particular one in Jesus Mon. Okay, so I'll begin. So Jean Daniel Lu, in his famous essay, The Present Orientations of Religious Thought, sets out the central problems facing theology in his time. According to Daniel Lu, the biggest problem facing theology today is the rupture between theology and life. This rupture springs from the fact that theology is not providing an adequate response to the challenges and experiences felt by modern men and women. For Daniel Lu, this rupture has led to a grave consequence in theology. Theology has lost its authentic significance for today's man. As a result, at the table of intellectual conversations, theology has lost its place because of its inability to address pressing questions. Consequently, theology has questions to answer so that it can address the issues raised by the spiritual experience of men and women today. What, however, are the precise deficiencies of theology? According to Daniel Lu, he points to a double deficiency. On the one hand, theology has failed to address the loss of the sense of divine transcendence in the lives of modern man. This, according to Daniel Lu, is caused by a trend of rationalization in theology that deals with God as though he's similar to just any other objects of thought. Consequently, it is inevitable that this trend of theological development fails to prevent the loss of a sense of divine mystery. Second, on the other hand, theology has become fossilized. It remains frozen in its forms and expressions, and so has lost contact with the recent developments in philosophy and science. As a result, Daniel Lu argues theology has lost its intellectual credibility due to its lack of ability to engage with these developments in modern philosophy and science. Daniel Lu's diagnosis of the modern condition of theology remains largely true today. In hindsight, we can now say that his optimism in 1946 might be premature. Theology, to a large extent, remains at the margins and to the lives of modern man in the West in largely secularized societies. As a discipline, theology is rarely recognized by the common man as the crucial dialogue partner in relation to our existential conversations. What steps then must theologians take to heal this rupture between theology and life? So troubled Daniel Lu in 1946, a problem that should remain a live issue for theologians today. In the 20th century, a group of Catholic theologians thought that the solution must involve a return to the Church Fathers, a re-engagement with the theology of those who were the fountainhead of Christian thinking. Between 1935 and 1961, Henri de Lubac, Jean Daniel Lu, and Hans-Urs von Balthasar published a series of monographs specifically devoted to Greek patristic theology. In this period, Balthasar published a patristic trilogy, and everything is on your handout. First, in 1936-7, Balthasar published a two-part study on Origen that was eventually published as a book in 1951 as Mystery and Speech in Origen. He never finished the monograph, but these articles serve as part of his original plan. In 1946, Balthasar then published Presence and Thought, an essay on the religious philosophy of Gregory of Nyssa. Finally, in 1941, Balthasar finished his trilogy by publishing his groundbreaking study on Maximus the Confessor, titled Cosmic Liturgy, Apex and Crisis of the Greek Conception of the Universe in Maximus. In the second edition, published in 1961, in response to criticisms raised by a new wave of Maximian scholarship, Balthasar renamed the work Cosmic Liturgy, The Universe According to Maximus the Confessor. And meanwhile, in 1950, de Lubac published his groundbreaking study, the famous book on Origen's spiritual exegesis, titled History and Spirit, The Understanding of Scripture According to Origen. And turning to Daniel Lu, he published his doctoral thesis in 1944, titled Platonisme and Théologie Mystique, Doctrine Spirituelle de Saint Grégoire de Nice. And finally, in 1946, Daniel Lu published his monograph on Origen, simply titled Origine. These titles are not exhaustive, but suffice to indicate the intense engagement with patristic theology by these three theologians in the crucial period leading up to the Second Vatican Council. In this paper, what I wish to explore is not the significance of these works for Vatican II, although this is a project on its own, I think. What I wish to explore, however, is to highlight the fact that these monographs were not the typical kinds of historical patristic studies carried out from the standpoint of the historical critical method common to patrologists. Even Daniel Lu's work, which conformed more than the others to the standard approach, were highly unusual in his selection of topics and overall portrayals of his subjects. And I want to suggest that the underlying all these monographs is a methodologically coherent vision of mending the rupture between theology and life that I started this paper with via a deep engagement with patristic theology. In other words, there was an intentional reconception of the nature and purpose of historical theology intended in these monographs. This methodological vision offers a way to reconceive patristic theology as something more than just archaeology of ancient thought, namely as a fruitful arena to think through theological problems endemic in modernity. Consequently, I suggest that the attempt to transform the nature and purpose of patristics is one of the most underappreciated aspects of Herzog's modern thinkers. So that's my main argument. The aim of the paper is thus to set out a case for my thesis that there is indeed a unified programmatic vision for theological renewal based on patristics to be found here. To support my thesis, I'll examine closely the way these monographs were conceived by analyzing various prefaces and introductions. Due to the limits of time, my analysis will be restricted upon two monographs in this paper, de Lubac's History and Spirit and Balthasar's Gregory of Nyssa monograph. It will become clear that in this two work resides a deeply coherent vision of approaching the Father as the vital source for renewal. Hence my title of the paper, Rethinking Patristics as a Source of Theological Renewal Today. But before turning to the Chrysostomal theologian, in the first part, I wish to set out a larger context for my undertaking, namely the changing role of patristic theology in modern discourse. In modernity, patristics has undergone a significant change of role. Before the early modern era, the Fathers played a key role as the witness to Orthodox Christian doctrines. The idea of consensus patrum serves as a highly authoritative tool for establishing theological orthodoxy or heterodoxy of any doctrines. Whenever there's a significant debate or controversy, such as the one in the Reformation, theologians would turn to establish the consensus patrum would turn to the consensus patrum to establish one's own position. In this way, from as early as Basil the Great to as late as John Calvin, from thinkers as varied as Maximus the Confessor to Thomas Aquinas, patristics, alongside scripture, serves as the source of proofs for theological disputes. However, since the 19th century, the consensus patrum is no longer as significant as it once was, especially outside ecclesiastical circles. And it is obvious that today it is no longer possible simply to highlight the father's theology as an authoritative argument or witness for one's own position. Instead, the role of patristics for theological discourse has been reconceived in various ways. So in the first part, I want to highlight this change of fate concerning the role of patristics by turning to Otto von Harnack, the famous German history of dogmatician, and Colin Gunton, who is actually died quite young, 20 years ago, a professor of systematic theology, who also had an interesting approach to reconceive patristics for modern theology. I do this first because it is within this context of the changing role of patristics where I want to situate the unique contribution of the Hesosmong thinkers, an aspect that I think is hitherto underappreciated. So I'll just go into these two approaches. As a result, this state of affairs illustrates that patristics ceases to function as consensus patrons after the 19th century, and so it became an open question as to how the thought of the fathers is relevant to the existential theological problems today. So section one, patristic theology and problem with theology in modernity. Given my subject matter, it's not surprising that I must begin with the great German historian Otto von Harnack. Amongst many of his great achievements, Harnack has bestowed modern theology an influential narrative that places patristic theology at the center of its diagnosis concerning the rupture between theology and life. This is the famous Hellenization thesis, where Harnack argues that the Catholic Church, as an institution, based on a system of dogma, emerged after primitive Christianity. So there is thus a change from primitive Christianity to the kind of dogmatic ecclesiastical Christianity that we know from kind of the Roman Catholic Church. What Harnack wants to highlight is that this change from primitive Christianity, that is about the religious sense of the divine, is replaced in a sense in the patristic period by a theoretical system of dogma. And this development, according to Harnack, sows the seed for the total separation between pure theoretical dogmatic theology on the one hand and practical spiritual life on the other. And we find this diagnosis in volume 2 of Harnack's magnum opus, The History of Dogma. And I'll give you a little quote just to get you into this 2,000 pages long tome that nobody probably read today. He writes, "The fixing of the tradition under the title of apostolic necessarily led to the assumption that whoever held the apostolic doctrine was also essentially a Christian in the apostolic sense. This assumption meant the separation of doctrine and conduct, the preference of the former to the latter, and the transformation of fellowship of faith, hope, and discipline into a communion justum sacramenti, that is, into a union which, like the philosophical schools, rested on doctrinal law, and which was subject to a legal code of divine institution." End quote. For Harnack, the creation of a doctrinal system of faith in the patristic period was due to the challenge posed by Gnosticism. In order to combat Gnosticism, a structured doctrinal system was necessary. However, Harnack is interested in the long-term consequences of this particular move, and according to him, the dogmatization of Christianity in this period meant that it is possible for the seriousness of religion to fade away from the core of Christianity. It is now possible for the church to be secularized. So it's very interesting that Harnack, as a historian, makes such a claim that you think a dogma, a church historian would make. It's baffling. It is now possible, according to Harnack, for the church to tolerate a less strict ideal of practical life, and for those who are less earnest in religious practice to become Christian. As long as they adhere to a system of dogma, theoretically, other practical commitment is not necessary. The result, in Harnack's estimation, is the loss of a communion of faith, hope, and discipline. In other words, Harnack argues the dogmatization of faith in patristic theology has created the possibility to have theology within within real faith, theoretical dogmas without authentic expression. Sorry. The dogmatization of faith has created the possibility of theology without real faith, theoretical dogmas without authentic spirituality. For Hannah, what the early fathers achieved in their theology was ultimately a legitimization of Greek philosophy within the sphere of the rule of faith. His evaluation concerning the synthesis between Greek philosophy and Christian faith in integral to the patristic vision of Christianity is summarized by his footnote on Luther's judgment, which I thought you might like. He highlights Luther had a profound impression that biblical Christianity and the theology of the fathers were two different things together. According to Luther, Hannah quotes, and Luther writes, "When the word of God comes to the fathers, methinks it is as if milk were filtered through a coal sack, where the milk must become black and spoiled." End quote. It is the theology of the fathers which Hannah identifies as the culprit to the problem pointed out by Daniel Liu, but discernible already in Hannah's time, namely the separation between doctrine and conduct, between theology and life. Hannah's argument for this diagnosis goes further into the doctrine of God, and here, unfortunately, I just have no time to go into it. There's really a big area here. According to him, patristic theology reduced the relations between God and the world, God and men specifically, to the creator-creature distinction. And Hannah writes, "For the fathers, there can only be one and the same relation on earth between God and free man, and that it has been conditioned by the creation. This thought, which presupposes the idea of God's unchangeableness, at bottom neutralizes every quasi-historical and mythological consideration." In other words, consideration which involves God in history, interacting with man and woman. According to Hannah, by stressing the metaphysical picture of God as first cause, unchangeable, immutable, the personal God who is involved in history, as described by the narrative of scripture, is collapsed into a static, historically involved God who relates to the world and man only at the level of cause and effect. Consequently, this theological scheme undermines the true doctrine of redemption of man by the grace of God, since it once again reduces this redemption narrative to yet another story at the metaphysical level, another story about logos and the inherent finitude of man. In modern idiom, we might say Hannah was worried about the reduction of sinfulness and redemption to his finitude and self-realization. So this is his sort of deeper criticism of patristics. For Hannah, the God of the fathers can only relate to man as cause and no more than that. Consequently, we lose the essence of the Christian gospel, redemption, achieved through God's intimate involvement with human affairs in history. The result is the possibility of conceiving God as totally distant, and thus leads to the rupture between theology and life. So I hope you get a whole picture of Hannah's idea of how patristic affect his present condition. Hannah's theology provides a first example of the kind of analysis I'm interested in this paper, funny enough. Hannah, as a church historian, kept a keen eye on the connection between patristic on the one hand and the present theological condition on the other. For him, this connection is profoundly negative. It is in patristics where we find the seeds that led to the rupture between theology and life. This Hannahian approach is influential in some circles in modern theology, most notably within the movement of process theology, if you know it, that was popular in the 20th century. But a Hannahian model is not the only significant attempt to reconceive patristics in modern era in relation to the problem of modernity. A second analysis, arguably more influential in Engel-Flom theology, is founded in the so-called modern Trinitarian revival. And in this domain, the Hannahian narrative is given a more narrow scope. For those of you who are not familiar, this is the idea that the doctrine of the Trinity has been forgotten for thousands of years, and only it was revived in the 19th century and 20th century by Karl Barth and Karl Rahner, because they suddenly realized that the doctrine has something to say to the real life of men and women, and this narrative kind of builds up enough, and so as a result falls into a kind of more narrow species of Hanauk's sort of narrative. The rupture between theology and life in modernity, according to this sort of movement, is chiefly due to the failure of Western patristic theologians, more specifically. Colin Gunton, one of the most famous proponents of this narrative in Britain, in his Bampton lecture, The One, the Free, and the Many, sets out a clear idea of this analysis. Gunton argues that the displacement of God in modernity is due to the fact that Western theology, following Augustine, has failed to take into account fully a Trinitarian account of God. Rather, Eastern patristic theology, chiefly the Cappadocian Fathers, Basil, and the two Gregories, preserves for us a dynamic account of the Trinitarian persons as communion that is not found in Western theology. Consequently, Eastern theology, so the narrative goes, is able to supply a theological basis for maintaining a close relationship between theology and life, because the Trinity as communion is pregnant with potential applications to historical temporal life. So, to start, God conceived as a communion of three persons provides a Trinitarian model for society that overcomes totalitarianism on the one hand, where unity is overstressed, and individualism and fragmentation on the other hand, where plurality is overstressed. Triunity is supposed to be a solution, so you get the idea. Further, in this case, theology becomes an important idea in modern discourse on politics and society. Further, God conceived as a communion of three persons provides a model for ecclesiology, how we think about the church, thus providing an intimate connection between theology and the spiritual life of the faithful. Further still, as suggested by some scholar, God conceived as communion of three persons may even provide an alternative framework of metaphysics, namely metaphysics of relationality instead of metaphysics of essence, where unity and diversity are integrally held together by this kind of idea of relationality, which I won't go into here. But what's argued here, basically, is that a narrow vision of Hanakian analysis. The rupture between theology and life in modernity is caused not by patristic theology as a whole, but by a faulty doctrine of God that is found specifically in post-Augustinian Western theology. And because of that faulty doctrine of God, as a result, theology has lost its ability to connect to important problems like society and vision of politics and vision of the church and metaphysics even. Consequently, turning eastward, according to this narrative, constitutes a necessary step to recover an engaged theology that is existentially relevant. Okay, so I think that's enough. So Hanak's thesis and Gunton's thesis offer two examples that delineate a distinctive theological approach. That's what I want to say. This is an approach to theology that recognizes historical theology as more than just archaeology, more than just archaeology of the past. On this view, patristics is no less existentially relevant than when consensus patrum was decisive for pre-modern thinkers. In the case of Hanak and Gunton, both of them conceive the fathers as holding the key for understanding the origin of problems in modernity. Historical details matters because this is intimately entangled with how we move beyond these kind of problems. So I get you to think through these examples because it's within this sort of distinctive approach to theology where I think I want to situate the Hesosmon thinkers and their approach to patristics in the 30s, 40s, and 50s. So that's why I have this section. Right, so now we can get to the meat of looking at Dürerbach and Barthes. So, section 2, Dürerbach and Barthesson's patristic Hesosmon. I'll now turn to substantiate my main claim, namely that there is a coherent and unified vision for seeking theological renewal via patristic theology in the monographs of the Hesosmon theologians. In the interest of time, I'll restrict just to Dürerbach's history and spirit and Balthasar's presence and thought. This is because in these two works, in the preface and the introduction, we find the most reflective articulation of their programmatic vision. In what follows, I'll first try to highlight three key observations that brings out the precise character of this programmatic vision in Dürerbach. And I'll then turn to Balthasar and point out that his approach to Gregory of Nyssa shares the same kind of features to Dürerbach's approach to origin. And consequently, I suggested the two monographs, though written in very different style and with a very different topic, subject matter, shares a profoundly unified vision in terms of how they conceive the nature and purpose of historical theology. So that's my argument. Okay. Let's begin with Dilu Bang. A superficial reading of his monograph would take us to the shallow conclusion that it's merely a study on the history of exegesis. Dilu Bang's monograph is no less than this, but it's certainly much more. The first observation I want to make concerns the content of this monograph. Dilu Bang is simply using history of exegesis as a medium to address a crucial question on the intellectual climate of his time, namely the meaning and proper role of historicity in theology. As Daniel Lewis highlighted in his programmatic essay I began this paper with, historicity constitutes one of the key questions that no engaged theology today can ignore. Hence, Dilu Bang's monograph is first and foremost an argument about whether the modern concern for historicity has totally led to a woeful imbalance that will be exposed by turning to Origen's spiritual exegesis. For Dilu Bang, the hostile judgment against Origen by modern exegetes perhaps put the nail to the head. That indeed, modern concern for historicity meant that a profound truth has been compromised, that there is a layer of reality beyond history, a truth so masterfully handled by Origen's thought. This, in my view, is what Dilu Bang is trying to describe by the following words, which I quote. He writes, "But as I look in those works of Origen for the necessary information for the project of history of exegesis, the subject I had at first envisioned assumed a broader scope in my eyes. It was no longer a matter of measuring in any given exegesis the part allotted to the letter and the part to the allegory. It was no longer even a matter solely of exegesis. It was a whole matter of thinking, a whole manner of thinking, sorry, a whole worldview that loomed before me." End quote. What is the whole worldview that loomed before Dilu Bang? It is, I suggest, a vision of Christianity that will not reduce anything to the purely historical level, but will possess a profound sense for the spirit that goes not in the contrary to the letter, to historicity, but through and beyond it. Thus, the content of Dilu Bang's monograph reveals that his approach to patristics is first and foremost driven by his concern to address the contemporary issue of historicity and to put the Father's theology in dialogue with contemporary philosophy. So that's the first thing I want to highlight. This leads me to the second observation on Dilu Bang's method. According to him, he is attempting to practice what he preached. In his monograph, he states that he's attempting a historical study on Origen. He intends his method to respect all the objective standards of historical sciences and all that. Where temporal context and, you know, the stuff that I do in my PhD, you know, third century and all the rest of it. But such a method is inadequate, argues Dilu Bang, if it's all that one does when it comes to study Origen, for two reasons. First, according to Dilu Bang, if he was attempting just to study a subject that is without the vitality of life, then perhaps the purely historical approach would suffice. But this is not the case with concerning Origen's exegesis. Because in the exegesis of this great Alexandrian father, we're faced with a spiritual synthesis, what Dilu Bang calls a system of thought, arising from the profound spiritual lift experience of the great theologian. And consequently, he argues that to understand this spiritual synthesis in Origen, we cannot just use the purely historical method. That would not get to the bottom of the subject matter, because subject matter is alive and cannot therefore be captured in this sort of method. So that's his first reason. And second, he argues that the spiritual exegesis of Origen is not an issue that is totally separated or disconnected from his own standpoint as a theologian and human being. So it's not an issue where it has nothing to do with contemporary life or church life in his case. And so if he was studying a figure or a problem that in no way affects him and his audience, then perhaps the purely objective method would suffice. But this is again not the case with regard to Origen's spiritual exegesis, because Dilu Bang argues that it fits into a tradition that touches integrally the being of the church today. So he really believes that the being of the church has such a huge heritage built upon Origen and his legacy of exegesis, that the subject matter is so entangled to the identity of the church today that you can't have a sort of disinterested, disengaged approach to Origen's exegesis. What does that mean? So what does that mean is that for him, it's necessary to approach Origen from the standpoint of one's lived experience and in conjunction with the historical approach. By being historical, without being historicist, the only appropriate method to approach Origen for Dillenberg and the criteria springs from, this is the only appropriate method, being historical and not historicist. And this springs from the fact that the great Alexandrian father's thought is neither totally disconnected from us, nor is it a dead subject matter. Rather, Origen's thought is a lived spiritual synthesis. And from this, a purely historical method will be lacking. My second observation has already touched the heart of Dillenberg's goal, which is my third point, in writing his provocative monograph. His goal is not to represent or re-describe a dead system of thought in its glorious details. Rather, the goal is to engage with Origen's thought as still affecting us today and alive. So this brings me to the final observation, that according to Dillenberg, the goal of his monograph is to, quote, bring out the essence of what is always, nearly always implicit. It must penetrate, this monograph must penetrate beneath the particularities of time and place to what is eternal. End quote. Dillenberg's goal is thus to identify what remains eternal, that is incarnated in the temporal and particular thought forms in Origen's exegesis. This is a crucial point I want to labor on to understand Dillenberg's project, namely in what sense he understood Origen as providing a way for theological renewal. So what does it mean to say that patristics gives a method for theological renewal? The answer is very much lies in what does it mean that you can look for the eternal forms or look for some sort of Platonic kind of absolute within the sort of passing contingent body of patristic writings. According to Dillenberg's conception of his project, what is significant about Origen is not the political historical details in his Alexandrian Platonism or his allegorical reading of particular texts. What is profoundly significant in Origen is that in his writings we find a vital spiritual synthesis that is particularly successful in putting his experience and his thought together. And through Origen's thought, we are thus offered a glimpse of how this process of vital synthesis occurs. For Dillenberg, the spirit of Origen's thought, beyond the letters, is precisely the eternal form that will once again revitalize theology today and enables it to move beyond its imbalances. So he ends his introduction with these beautiful words, which I cannot resist quoting. He writes in this beautiful, typical way. He said, "The river does not flow back to its source. No more than life itself does thought retrace its steps. Even if it wished to do so, no miracle would allow such a dream to be realized. Yet perhaps, after the long course it has just run through the parched lands of rationalism and positivism, it will find itself more likely to be understood and even taken in today, in order to bring life in us what is expressed of the eternal in these forms now dead." He's talking about the exegesis, the dead forms. "The wells once dug by Origen have long been covered over with sand, but the same deep layer of water is still there, which he can help us find once again in order to quench the same thirst." End quote. Thought, no more than life, according to Dillenberg, can retrace his steps. So he's not advocating a return to Originian exegesis, by no means. Besides, the rupture between Origen and our times is too great. The river does not flow back to its source anymore. But the layer of water that Dillenberg referred to is precisely what I've called the spirit of Origen's thought, the vital creative energy that Dillenberg sought to make available again for contemporary theology, albeit through its incarnated form in Origen's exegesis. How is this possible? According to Dillenberg, by reproducing within ourselves the movement of the spirit that once made Origen's text come alive. So for Dillenberg, the goal, the key to patristics, is to find a way to help the reader somehow to reproduce this wellspring of spirit that integrates Origen's experience with his exegesis, his thought, so that when we go through his works, we don't necessarily just get entangled with the particularities of his exegesis, but actually learn from imitating, seeing, as it were, a live experiment of synthesis, so that we ourselves get this sort of creative energy to do the same in our times. And for him, the patristics authors were particularly important because they were particularly successful in certain eras and in certain figures where the system has such a long legacy. And that's why they kind of home in on some of these Greek fathers. Okay, so I'll now tell you Balthasar. And Balthasar's monograph of Pilgrim of Nyssa contains a particularly important foreword because it serves as the programmatic vision to his trilogy that was never completed. So he never finished his Origen monograph, but instead produced two short articles, well, 50 pages, as well as an anthology of Origen's writings alongside this monograph on Gregory and the famous one on Maximus. Just to give you an idea, Balthasar started reading patristics when he was a student at Lyon Fauvier with Dulubac for 3 years. During those 3 years, he famously said every single class of dogmatics, he was not listening, he was reading the father in original Greek. And after that, he produced an incredible, I think at least 10 volumes on patristics. So monographs, two monographs, the Origen articles, an anthology on Augustine, anthology on Irenaeus, anthology on the Greek apologists, anthology on Origen, the revision of Maximus' monograph, and a few other short articles on Maximus' relationship with Dionysius the Areopagite, and on the scholia on Dionysius, and I can't remember the last one. He produces all that consequent to his inspiration from Dulubac, his mentor, to see patristics as a renewal program. And of course in his trilogy, I can't remember which volume, I think it's Theological Aesthetics, number 2, the whole second half of it is basically on Irenaeus, Gregory of Nyssa, Dionysius of the Areopagite. So Balthasar's patristic work is everywhere in his corpus. So here I'm just honing in on, I think, a key to see his engagement in his foreword to Gregory of Nyssa's monograph. What I wish to show more briefly is that the approach to patristic found in Balthasar's monograph follows a programmatic vision, very similar to the one we've seen in Dulubac, with regards to content, method, and goal. So, much more briefly, and I'm getting to the end. So. First, the content. The key thesis put forward by Balthasar in this monograph is that Gregory's thought displays a twofold character that is at once dramatic and conceptual, existential and essential. According to Balthasar, Gregory has often been approached through the latter, that's the conceptual and the essential, but not through the former. He thus sets out in the monograph to demonstrate that the heart of Gregory's religious philosophy is the central mystery of existence. According to Gregory, it is impossible to know what God is, pos esti, but only that he is, hoti esti. So, drawing on this emphasis on the incomprehensibility of the divine essence, Balthasar argues that Gregory interprets the idea of being in a way that radically differs from Neoplatonism. Instead of treating being as referring to a divine essence, which for Gregory is impossible to know, Gregory instead treats it as referring to a divine existence, so referring to the fact that that God is. On the one hand, God as being manifests himself is a feeling of presence, so Gregory makes it possible for the religious believer to know this presence, the hoti esti of God. But on the other hand, this feeling is constantly accompanied by the failure of all human attempts to grasp conceptually what manifests in this presence. And for Gregory, this is the key dialectic in Gregory of Nyssa's thought. That's why the monograph is called Presence and Thought. And presence in the sense of God as existent, and thought in the sense of the constant failure of our conceptual grasp of this existence. And he thinks this is a heart of how Gregory of Nyssa thinks about the whole structure of theology. Balthasar writes, and I'll just give you Yes, for Balfour's are the key dialectic reveals Gregory possess a force of existence. He writes, the being that is present in essence must be found without, however, confusing it with essence or expressing it by way of essence. All knowing that is essential already presupposes an existential faith. And then here he quotes Gregory. Gregory writes, first, we must believe that a thing is, and only then we can define what this object that is believed is. And end quote. Without going into further details, what is certain is that Balthasar here must have the philosophical debates concerning the relation between essence and existence in mind in contemporary existentialism. When he approached Gregory of Nyssa, he must be reading, I don't know, Jasper or Sartre or whatever. Just as de Lubac's monograph uses Origenian exegesis as a medium to treat the question of historicity, so Balthasar uses Gregory's religious philosophy as a medium to treat the question of existence so central to his time. Both monographs thus share a common desire to put modern philosophical question in dialogue with patristic theology. So that's the first point. The content is always in direct connection with live debate in the intellectual climate of the time. Second, the goal and method of Balthasar's approach to patristics are intimately connected with one another. For Balthasar, return to the fathers must be robustly non-historicist, as for de Lubac. This is because the goal for patristic as hesosmos must have in mind the eternal truths incarnated in temporal thought forms. And here Balthasar has a much more elaborate theory on this, as those of you who know Balthasar, you know that he has a very elaborate theory of how this eternal and temporal the theory of time and how it interacts. For Balthasar, as for de Lubac, it's the task of patristic hesosmos to provide crucial examples of how Christian thinkers in the past have brought about a creative synthesis between their lived experience and their thoughts, so that today this vitality of synthesis will be once again made available. What matters are thus not the historical forms in which synthesis occurred. As he put it, the past and present are never identical. As a result, mere repetition of material thought patterns and past synthesis will not help man today to face his own problems. A new problem awaits a new solution. Balthasar is therefore adamantly opposed to any sort of neo-patristic theology that suggests some kind of master key found in the past thinkers for present problems. Rather, for Balthasar, patristic is fruitful and vital for theological renewal only if it fulfills one condition, if it imposes the burden on us to be creative in our own attempt at a synthesis between experience and thought, rather than dispensing us from that responsibility. So as we were talking about to think, the burden to think, he says one and only condition for us to do patristic today is if it gives us the burden, gives us the burden to actually think creatively on our problems today, rather than dispensing us that burden and allow us some sort of refuge in the thought form of the past. He said if that happens, then it's absolutely useless to study patristics. Only if it helps us to see that because in these guys, the synthesis had occurred in such a wonderful way to deal with their situation, now the burden is on us to imitate the same kind of process. And that's the whole point of studying what has happened in the fathers. So if this study of the fathers inspires a renewal of creative vitality for Balthasar, then indeed return to patristics could become a useful method of renewal. Balthasar's characteristically rich language on this point conveys a vivid picture of his conception of patristics. And I'll give you another beautiful paragraph just to lighten up a bit. He writes, we remember it as a man remembers the profound intuitions he had as an adolescent. If he cannot relive them just as they were, because his situation, his life, indeed the whole world have changed for him, he can at least fortify himself with the thought that the purity of inspiration, that burning and impatient resonance of his whole being, is his very self. We should like to reread a few pages of that intimate journal written by the church when she was 17 years old. This we do from the same distance of age, but also with the same respectful admiration for the person we once were. End quote. In this picture, patristics is presented as a kind of spiritual exercise that has its goal to regain a memory, a sense of vitality, so that we can experience anew once more the vital wellsprings of the spirit that once directed the thoughts of the fathers, for them to come up with a theology in response to their own situation. From this, we may learn from the fathers how to creatively respond to our own unique and concrete situations, theologically. By turning once more to the past, to the tradition, Balthasar suggests patristics could help the church to learn to act creatively once more. With this goal in mind, for Balthasar, the method of doing patristics must not be over-concerned with presenting outdated solution to outdated problems. And you find every single time in this patristic paragraph, he says, here, I will not go into the historical detail because my goal is to give you the intuition, the vitality that drives what's going on in these pages. And that's my goal. And I'm happily relying on the people who are doing the footnotes. And in all the monographs, he has something along the same lines written in the beginning of his monograph, which strikes me as something that's always on his mind when he writes monographs on patristics. Yes, so to do patristics is not to be over-concerned with presenting outdated solutions. It must, in Balthasar's own words, teach us the acts and deeds of the Church, to present her treasure of divine revelation ever new and ever unexpected to every generation, and who knows how, in the face of every new problem, to turn the fecundity of the problem to good account, with a rigor that never grows weary and a spiritual agility that is never dulled. And for those of you who know stuff about Balthasar, I'd really like to know more about the sort of epistemological background to his whole understanding of history, you know, his whole hermeneutical account, because I think I'm not there yet. I'm still trying to figure out what's going on there. So, conclusion, you'll be glad to know. In this paper, I've presented a snapshot of my argument that the patristic monographs of the heads of small theologians contain within them a coherent, unified vision of historical theology as a means for theological renewal in the present. In response to the rupture between theology and life, in modernity, De Lubac and Balthasar both attempted to carry out patristics in a manner that sought to provide resources to mend this rupture. I've suggested that their approach is characterized by three features. First, a concern for putting patristic theology in dialogue with contemporary intellectual conversation. Second, a conviction that patristics, a conviction that patristics, fruitful for theological renewal, must be historical but not historicist. Third, a conception that engagements with patristics could put us in contact with a once vital spirit that enabled past thinkers to synthesize their own unique and concrete experience with their theological expressions. I suggest that the Heselsmann theologian's framework makes a substantial contribution to an open question that is largely unresolved today. What is the relation between the Father's theology and the rupture between theology and life today? In my estimation, the Heselsmann theologians can see for the first time a coherent and unified approach to patristics as a unique resource for addressing the existential problems we face today. Consequently, the patristic monographs of De Lubac and Balthasar can be read as pioneer and renewal of the theological role for patristics in modern theology, and as such, replaces its old role as consensus patrum. This may well be one of the lasting theological achievements of Heselsmann. Thank you.